Good evening. It's not quite, of course, the CT, the PET CT together. So we're going to see the indications of PET CT. It's actually 30, 40 minute talk. I'm trying to push it to the 20 minute slot that we have here. So basically, PET CT. So we have the oncological indications for PET CT and the non-oncological indications of PET CT. For the oncological indications, all of you know that PET CT is very ideal for staging of cancer, for baseline treatment in certain conditions, for response to evaluate the response to therapy, in evaluation of SPNs and evaluation of suspected disease recurrence or relapse, and to guide biopsies. Cancer of mammary nodule is a big problem, and PET CT helps in trying to identify the primary. Differentiate between radiation necrosis and tumor recurrence in certain cases, and in medullary carcinoma of the thyroid, we do use PET CT. So this is another new group where PET CT, we have started using PET CT a lot in dementia and epilepsy, in cardiac viability, and the most important now, we are almost doing one PET CT every day, evaluating for evaluation of pyrexia of mammary nodule. So what PET CT basically, what do we do? We get an informed consent. We need the patient at a 6 hours fasting. A blood sugar of about 100 to 150 is required, and we inject 5 millicuri of 18 fluoroxydeoxyglucose. Now this is a nuclear medicine that we mix it with FDG, and patient is made to rest for 40 minutes. And then we take the patient for the scan. We give him both oral and IV contrast, do a full body CT, and then acquire the PET, and then fuse the PET and CT, evaluate. I'm just going to show you a lot of images. I'll rush through them. This is for staging of cancers, PET CT is ideal. This is a case of lymphoma. As you can see, multiple nodes in the cervical region, in the supraclavicular mediastinal region, in the upper retroperitoneal region. And interestingly, if you can see that there is an increased uptake in the spleen, which is more than that of the liver. So which means spleen is also involved in this case. So this is the MIP image, full-blown disease of lymphoma, stage 3C. 3S. Lymphoma staging, we add S if the spleen is involved, we add B if the bone is involved. Another case, here we see that, these are the places where the PET plays an important role. Here we see a cancer at the floor of the mouth, involving the tongue and metastatic cervical nodes. Normally, we would operate this case and then go in for RT. But the consultants are more referred for a PET CT. Other than the cervical nodes and the lesion in the floor of the mouth, we found a solitary skeletal metastasis at D6 vertebrae. So now this patient had to be given shifted for chemo. Another case, interesting, a focal lesion in the bleeding per vagina, focal lesion in the cervix turned out to be adenocarcinoma. Carcinoma. No pelvic nodes, but then she had nodes in the mediastinum and the supraclavicular. A normal CT wouldn't have picked up, you would only do a CT of the abdomen or an MRI of the abdomen. The whole body PET CT, we pick up these nodes in the mediastinum and supraclavicular region, and a small node in the cervical region level 2. FNA of this was also positive. This is very typical of cervix. There's a focal lesion here in the cervix, nothing in the media, in the abdomen, but then metastatic nodes in the chest and the supraclavicular region. GIST. Now, PET is an essential before starting treatment for GIST. For imatinib, only if the lesion is hot or PET positive can we give imatinib. Only then it will work. Otherwise, it won't work. So this is a patient where. Surgery was done for a jejunal GIST. Post-surgery, about 1 year later, he developed recurrence. Multiple peritoneal deposits enter in the entire abdomen. This is 2014. We start imatinib therapy, and this is 2016. There is no uptake in any of these lesions. The lesions have considerably reduced in size. He had multiple liver mets. Those liver mets have also significantly regressed. No uptake, significant necrosis. This is 2016, this is pre-treatment and this is post-treatment. So we see dramatic results in this with imatinib, but only if they are PET positive. In the pre-treatment, you have to do a PET, and if the PET positive, then imatinib works, otherwise it doesn't. Again, for the evaluation of response to therapy, this is a case of CS stomach, large mass at the body and pyloric tantrum. Large mass at the pyloric tantrum, this is pre-treatment, this is post-treatment. We see that significant reduction in size and metabolic activity. This is like midway, maybe 3 cycles post-chemo, so we know that patient is responding. And you know, the doctor continues the chemo and then goes for surgery again. See, but then we see some few lesions in the lung which was not there before. These could be chemo-induced inflammatory changes. So this we have to be careful. PET will also be positive in infections. So we have to take a call on this. But you know, most of these are central lobular nodules, interstitial thickening, more like infection post-chemo. Here again, a case, typical case of lymphoma. The lymphomas are, you know, are very, if they respond very well. So this is, you know, this is stage 4 lymphoma, pre-treatment, post-treatment. Totally there are no nodes at all, completely resolved. No metabolic activity anywhere. This is pre-treatment again, post-treatment images. Lot of nodes, all the nodes are resolved. He actually had multiple pulmonary deposits as well. Those pulmonary deposits are also resolved after 6 cycles of chemotherapy. Now, this SPN has been a debated topic, what to do, you know, especially if a patient is 60 years, 70 years, they present with a small nodule in the lung, how do we go about it? PET has tried to give answers for a lot of these patients. Like in this case, he had a solitary pulmonary nodule, nothing else, no mediastinal nodes. We did a PET, we found lesions in the bone. We had very, very small mediastinal nodes. CT would have said they are inflammatory, but then PET was positive, this, and this is his bone. So multiple bone metastasis, small SPN, and it was a case of adenocarcinoma of the lung. Another SPN, this one again a small, no symptoms at all, small nodule, no uptake in PET, and then the CT, if you do correction, we could see that, you know, it was almost the HU of about, you know, the fluid level, and it was actually a bronchocele which had got infected. So this is the MIP image, no uptake at all anywhere in the body. So a PET can give a call on SPN on how do we go about it. And for disease recurrence, PET is the choice of investigation. This was a case of CA rectum who was operated, RT was given, and this was 1 year follow-up. He was totally asymptomatic, no disease at all. This is 2 years follow-up. He developed deposit in the peritoneum, exactly at the site where post RT was given. And this is metastasis. He also developed metastasis in the lung. Multiple metastasis in the lung as well. This is the case of CA esophagus. RT was given. Post RT images, there's nothing in the esophagus. 1 year follow up, we see that patient has again got a wall thickening at the esophagus with increased uptake. This is recurrence at the treated site. Now, PET can also be very useful in biopsy sites. For example, this is a mass in the lung. If only a CT had been done for this lesion, we know that there is a mass and surrounding consolidation. Where to do the biopsy? If a CT guided biopsy was done, we could do it like this, which is the easiest way to go about doing the biopsy. But then you would take a sample at the periphery, which is not actually hot on PET. This is actually the surrounding consolidation, whereas this region is hot. So this is what we call a metabolic biopsy. After the PET, we know which region is hot, we go to that site and then we get the exact yield and, you know, the correct diagnosis. So repeat of biopsies can be avoided if you do a metabolic biopsy. Do a PET and then do a biopsy. Exact same patient, we see that, you know, that there is mass here and there is uptake here, whereas periphery there is no uptake. If PET helps us to guide the biopsy site. Now, cancer of unknown origin is unknown primary is becoming a common problem. Now, we see patient presenting with only metastatic nodes. We do a biopsy of those nodes. It turns out to be metastatic squamous or adeno. And then we keep looking for the primary. Now, PET has given the answer, at least at 80% of the cases in the studies that we have done, PET is able to identify the primary. This was a patient with back pain, MRI done, multiple bone metastases. Looking for the primary, multiple bone mets again. Small nodules in the lung, which are metastatic, but then PET shows a focal uptake. at the pyloric antrum of the stomach. If you see, actually the CT, there's not much of wall thickening, but very focal uptake in the stomach. Endoscopy was done, a biopsy proven CS stomach with bone metastasis. Similar patient, same patient in coronal section. This is another case, large mass at the cervix, it was at the cervical region. It was a large cervical node. Biopsy was done, it was a squamous cell carcinoma. Now we started looking for the primary. Multiple nodes again, and we see here a focal uptake at the nasopharynx. Almost similar to left and right, but then this focal uptake in the nasopharynx, an endoscopy was done, this was a primary squamous cell nasopharynx with metastasis to the cervical nodes. If you identify the primary, the treatment becomes better and focused, and you know they respond very well. This is pre-treatment, this is post-treatment, we see there's complete